Welcome to Glad Tidings Church Online. I'm Pastor Eric Revy, lead pastor of Glad Tidings Church. If you like this video, please click on the subscribe button and click the bell notification and change your notifications to all. That way, you will always be notified when we upload a new video and you don't want to miss them. Also, if you'd like to support this ministry, you can do so by going to our website, gladtidingschurch.ca. Once again, thank you for joining us and may you enjoy this experience. El Shaddai, God Almighty, God in heaven. Let me start it off with a story. A man went fishing on the river in springtime. The water levels were high and the waters were moving quickly. Knowing that he could not row his boat against the current, he tied a boat to a tree and let the rope out so that he could be offshore. However, the line broke and the boat was swept downstream, hit a rock, and was broken into pieces, clinging to the wreckage. The fisherman cried out for help and was being swept along. A passerby downstream saw what was happening, raced ahead to a small bridge. Lying down, the rescuer hung his arm over the edge of the bridge and yelled, "Grab my hand!" The fisherman, hearing the voice and seeing only the hand reaching out, did not know whether or not to trust the hand of the unseen or to keep clinging onto the wreckage. Fortunately for him, he let go of the wreckage and grabbed the hand reaching down, and he was pulled to safety. Bill Gaither once wrote a song that said, "There is an unseen hand to me that leads me through ways I cannot see. While going through this world of woe, this hand still leads me as I go." I can personally vouch and testify to the time that when I was going through that most difficult time in my life, it seemed like God was far off. God was not there. God was nowhere, and the heavens were silent, and I couldn't see God, but I know that he was there. Today, we're concluding our series on God revealed. Today, I want to talk about the power of God. Have you ever felt like that fisherman at times? And in the story, being swept downstream and powerless to do anything about it. Sometimes with the way 2020 has gone and the way 2021 is going, we sometimes feel like we're being swept downstream and we have no control over our lives. And I think we sometimes feel like that. And feeling powerless is difficult. We want to be in control. And I'm the type of guy, I like to be in control. But often we face situations that we have no control over. So where do we find power in our lives and in this world when with so many problems, so many difficulties, and we find it in the hand of God? See, Abraham was 75 years old when God called him to leave his home and set up for the land that he would show him. And he told Abram that he would give him children. In chapter 15 of Genesis, God shows Abram the stars in the sky and says, "So shall your offspring be." Now, get understand, at age 99, Abram still had no children, and it doesn't seem possible that he would have any. So this brings us to our story, our text. If you have your Bibles, and be on the screen behind me or in front of you watching it there at home. Genesis 17, verses 1 to 4 says this. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. I will confirm my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers." Abram fell face down, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be a father of many nations." Wow. See, God changed Abram's name to Abraham, which means father of many nations. A year later, his son Isaac was born, and God identified himself here as God Almighty, God of heaven, God Almighty, El Shaddai. The Almighty, the infinite God of creation, loves us and is for us. You need to understand this. God is not against you. He doesn't have some vendetta against you. God is for you. In this world, the Bible tells us we will have troubles. And God offers to us his power. It is impossible to live the life that God intends for us to live without it. Billy Graham once wrote this: Satan doesn't care how much you theorize about Christianity or how much you profess to know Christ. What he opposes vigorously is the way you live Christ. He doesn't care if you come to church when we're able to be in church and sit in the pew. He doesn't care. He doesn't even care if you sing along with the hymns and drop a couple things in the offering plate. But when you get serious with God, when you are vigorously walking and living for Christ, the way you become an instrument of mercy and compassion and love through which he manifests himself to the world. If Satan can take the heat, the motive, and the mercy of Christianity, the heart, so I should say, the motive and Christianity of Christianity, he has killed his effectiveness. If he can successfully get us to talk about the good case of religion but live a poorer one, then he has stripped us of all power. He doesn't care what we do as long as you don't become serious with God. God knew that we would have this need of his power, that many of us would live powerless lives. He says, I am the answer to your need. I am the all-powerful God. I like what Psalm 68 says when it says these words in 32, verse 32. Sing to God, O kingdom of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord. To him who rides the ancient skies above, who thunders with a mighty voice. Proclaim the power of God, whose majesty is over Israel, whose power is in the skies. You are awesome, O God, in your sanctuary. The God of Israel gives power and strength to his people. Praise be to God. Most of us here do not question the fact that God is powerful. We understand that, at least I think on an intellectual level, that God is very big. The real question is whether God's power is available to us today or to you today. We can count on God's power. When can we count on God's power? All the time, but especially. If you're taking notes, write these down. First one is when I am tired. Is anyone tired today? I know I am. I'm tired of this pandemic. I'm tired of 2020. In fact, I was tired in 2019. I'm already tired of 2021 already. It's only, what, May? I know that you can feel the same way. The good news is that I can count on God's power when I'm tired. And so can you. I think most of us know this verse. It's been in the verse that I have repeated to myself many, many times throughout the past couple years. In Isaiah chapter 40, it says this: Do you not know, have you not heard, the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth? He will not grow tired or weary. And his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. If we left it there, we would say, that sums up 2020, 2021, whatever year. But verse 31 gives us the hope that we need. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. I want to say that again. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. I want us to memorize that verse. It's a good one. Write it down, hang it on the fridge. You need to memorize that verse. If you have a journal, write it down in the journal. 1 Chronicles 28:20 says these words in the Good News Bible. Be strong and courageous and get to work. Don't be frightened by the size of the task. For the Lord, my God, is with you. He will not forsake you. He will see to it that everything is finished correctly. Wow. The context of that verse is taken from that David was encouraging his son Solomon to finish building the temple. David knew that it was a big job and that his son would get tired along the way and that he would need to trust in God for his strength to complete it. In the NIV, the verse reads this. David also said to Solomon, his son, be strong and courageous and do the work. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord, my God, is with you. He will not fail you or forsake you until all the work for service of the temple of the Lord is finished. We can apply that verse to our lives today. God will not leave us. God will not forsake us. He will be with us until it's time for us to go home. I don't mean in your home where you are now. I mean in our home in heaven. God's strongest saints realize that their weakness and appeal for his strength. And one Sunday morning, Charles Spurgeon passed through the back door of the pulpit in the tabernacle. And he saw a great crowd of people, and he was overheard saying this, "Oh, God, help." Those times I have said that. There's times you've said that. Strong as he was, he realized that he was insufficient for so great a task as preaching the gospel in power unless God would be his helper. When you're tired, trust God and his power to help you. Second of all, when you feel small, when I feel small, do you ever feel small? When was the last time you felt small? You don't have to be physically small to feel small. Has there ever been a time recently when you just felt inadequate for a task that was before you, for the job that you had to do? Ever felt like you were over your head? And maybe you're faced a situation that was so large that you just felt small by comparison. Remember the time when Israel sent the spies into the promised land to look at the promised land? In Numbers 13, it tells us that story. It says, but the men who had gone up with him said, we cannot attack those people. They are stronger than we are. Well, he was correct. And they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they explored. They said, the land we explored devours those living in it. Now, that's a really unique word. The land we explore devours those living in it. All the people we saw there are of great size. We saw the Nephilim there. Now, if you want to know a real good word study and historical study, we don't have time to go into it today, but study the group of the Nephilim. I'll leave that there. That'd be a bit of a homework for you to do later on. Verse 33, we saw Nephilim there. We seemed like grasshoppers in our own eyes, and we looked the same to them. When the enemy looks like a giant, you can feel like a grasshopper. You get a grasshopper mentality. I understand that feeling because those times I feel the same. There are a lot of times when I feel inadequate. Is that too honest? Is that too brutally honest? I feel like sometimes I have nothing to offer. So what do I do when that happens? When I'm faced with a situation and people are wanting answers and they're asking questions and they're wanting answers and I don't have the answers to them. It's easy to feel inadequate, feel small, feel like you're out of control, feel like you're out of your realm, you're over your head. Sometimes in my mind, I just want to go home, shut the blinds, turn on my tablet, and binge Netflix. I mean, I just want to shut everyone out and say, just leave me alone. I can't take it anymore. Like, am I being too honest? I'm sorry if you thought of me as some mighty spiritual giant that has no issues or problems or doesn't stumble or fall, because if that's your image, then I'm sorry, you are mistaken. I like the song that Amy Grant years ago wrote called "The Warrior Is a Child." Falls down. Yes, I am a warrior. Yes, I'm a fighter. But there's sometimes I just want to go home, flip on my tablet, have a cup of coffee, shut the blinds so no one can see me, and binge Netflix. Am I being too honest here? But you want to know what really helps me? Is when I turn to Jesus. Paul understood this. In 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9 and 10, he says, "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me.' That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses and insults and hardships and persecutions and difficulties." I'm thinking, are you nuts? "For when I'm weak, then I'm strong." So you know what I do? And I'll be honest with you. Sometimes I do go home and I binge watch a show on Netflix. Then after I realize, okay, this isn't helping, I turn to Jesus. Should do that first. But how many of us actually do that? When I face a giant, I don't measure it against my own weaknesses, but against God's strength. One of the movies that we watch at Christmas time is the movie called Elf. I love that movie. It's a fantastic movie. Will Ferrell plays the man who, as a baby, stows away in Santa's bag of toys. When they find him at the North Pole, they don't know what to do with him. So they raise him as an elf. They dress him like an elf. They treat him like an elf. They try to teach him how to make toys like an elf. And as time passes, it becomes more and more clear that he's not an elf. He just doesn't fit in. Eventually, they have to tell him the truth and to send him back into the world to find out who he really is. While you may live in this world, you are not of this world. If you are a believer, this is not your world. This is not your home. We've lost that concept over the years. Our home is in heaven. We are part of the family of God. You may look like the people around you, but you are, or you should be, different. You're a child of God. We need to act like children of God. I found this story. It says, while walking through the forest one day, a farmer saw a young eagle who had fallen out of the nest, and he took it home and put it in his barnyard, where it soon learned to eat and behave like the chickens. One day a tourist passed by the farm and asked, "Why is that king of all birds should be confined to live in a barnyard with chickens?" The farmer replied, "Well, since he had given it chicken feed and trained it to be a chicken, it never learned to fly. Since it now behaved like a chicken, it was no longer an eagle. Still, it had the heart of an eagle," replied the tourist. "And it can surely be taught to fly once again." He took and lifted the eagle out toward the sky and said, "You belong in the sky, not to the earth. Stretch forth your wings and fly." However, the eagle was just confused, and he did not know who he was. And seeing the chickens eating the food, he jumped down and began to be with them once again. The tourist took the bird up to the roof of the barn and urged him again, saying, "You are an eagle. Stretch forth your wings and fly." But the eagle was afraid of his unknown self and world, and jumped down once more for the chicken food. Finally, the tourist took the eagle out of the barnyard to a high mountain. And there he held the king of the birds high above him and encouraged him to fly, saying again, "You are an eagle. You belong to the sky. Stretch forth your wings and fly." Then the tourist lifted him up and threw him off the edge of the mountain. And the eagle fell. The wings snapped open, and soon it was soaring high above. It may be that the eagle still remembered the chickens with nostalgia. It may even be that he occasionally maybe revisited the barnyard again, but he could never go back to being a chicken. Why? Because that's not who he is. That's not who he was. We have been taken out of this world. We are a brand new creation, a brand new person that God has created us. This is not our world. Why do we want to go back to it? Why? God is our strength. No matter how weak or small we may feel, we need to remember that we are in Christ. We can count on God's power when we're tired, when we feel small, and when you feel torn. Number three, there are a lot of people that are hurting right now. God did not create us to live in isolation. We know that domestic violence has gone through the roof. And we've got people overdosing on narcotics in record numbers. Suicides have gone up all around us. People are struggling relationally, financially, emotionally, and spiritually. In 2019, 1.5 million children called a crisis helpline. In 2020, 4.9 million called the same crisis helpline. 70 to 80% of those kids that those called were suicidal in nature. And people wonder why that we have been wanting to get back into in-person services. We were made to be in fellowship with one another. I recently read an article that the Hamilton Spectator, that the ICUs, yes, they are full, but they're full of young people who have attempted suicides. Our world is messed up, folks. And we have the answer. The pain is very real. And we hope. And we spoke a few weeks ago that how God is our healer. And today I want to remind you to remember that there is nothing that can happen to us in life that is greater than God. You may be watching today. You may be feeling some of those effects. You may have had family members. And if you're a parent, you know the struggles that you're going through trying to, do your work, do your job. And then with your kids' education, everything coming together, our world is in a mess right now. We need Jesus. We need Jesus. 1 Peter 5:10 and 11 says these words. And the God of all grace, who has called us to eternal joy in Christ, after you suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. You need to hang on. Lean on Jesus. Turn, when you are going through these crises in your life, turn to Jesus. All the words that Peter used here are words indicating strengthening. When Peter says that here that God will restore you, he's using the word that means to mend. The meaning of the word is clear, especially for Peter. He understood it. If we look at Matthew chapter 4, verse 21, that's talked about going on from there. He saw the two brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, and they were in the boat with their father Zebedee preparing or mending their nets. Peter knew the concept of mending. And this is the same word he's using. God will restore you. God will mend the broken pieces, the broken things in your life. When Jesus first came and called Peter, he was in his boat mending nets. After Peter had denied the Lord three times, he was back fishing on the lake. And when Jesus again came, he said, "Throw out your nets." Although we were not told, Peter probably was mending his nets. And as he was in the boat and had been fishing all night, the net was in the boat at the same time as they were able to throw out immediately. As they were mending their nets, Jesus came to Peter to remind him this. Like a net, there are times in our lives that we are torn. when the weight of the world and our sin will tear us to pieces and tear us in places. Jesus came to Peter and helped to mend his life back together, making him strong and useful again for service. God wants to mend your life, and maybe you have areas in your life that are broken. Allow him to mend those, but you have to turn to him. My fourth and final point, I'll be closing off in just a couple moments. When I'm tempted. As we talked about last week, sometimes we have pain in our lives because we make bad choices. I don't know about you, but there have been times in my life where I've made some pretty bad choices. We have given into temptation and we have sinned. There's a bumper sticker that says, "Lead us not to temptation. I'm perfectly capable of finding it on my own." I don't know about you, but I can relate to that. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12, "So if you think that you are standing firm, be careful that you do not fall. No temptation has seized you except what is common to man, and God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it." Someone once wrote these words, "The power of God reminds us that there is no prayer too hard for him to answer. There is no problem too difficult for him to solve. There is no need too great for him to supply. There is no passion too strong for him to subdue. And there is no temptation too great for him to deliver us from. His power is greater than all. His purpose will achieve it, and it will be achieved. The victory is in God's hands. God always provides a way out. He gives us strength to say no to sin. You can count on God's power when you are tried, when you are tired, when you feel small, when you feel torn, when you are tempted." So how will you respond to this message today? First, you need to admit that you're weak. It's okay to recognize that you're not okay. There's a song about that, actually. It starts by understanding our need and not trying to live our life in our own strength. Not trying to live our life on our own strength. Secondly, stay connected to Christ. When we are on our own, we need to realize that we need to be connected to Christ. Let me ask this. How's your prayer life? How's your devotion life? When's the last time you picked up your Bible just to have God speak to you? When's the last time you just knelt at on your knees just to talk to your Heavenly Father without asking him anything? Third, choose faith over force. Trust God's power, not your own. Trust God's power, not your own. I don't know where you might be today. I don't know what you might be facing. I know that there are some that you're struggling financially. You're struggling relationally. Some of you, you're not doing well in this isolation situation we're in. When will it will get better? When? We don't know. We're praying soon. Others, you're struggling with your relationship with your husband, with your wife, with your kids. Some of you are struggling with your relationship with God. I want to close off this series with a prayer for you. That throughout this, that God gave us these names so that we could see part of his character. These are just a few of the names that he has given to us. That we can see his character and how he deals with us. He is El Shaddai, God Almighty, God of the heavens, who's able to come and to be a part of our lives and help us walk through every single detail we go through in our life, every challenge, every difficulty, every roadblock, every bump in the road. God is right there if you allow him to. Would you do that this morning? May I pray with you in just a moment? And if you don't know Jesus, my prayer is that you would recognize your need of Jesus in your life. And you would ask him to come into your life, to come into your heart. You would ask him to forgive you of your sins. Ask him to be your Lord and Savior and give your life to him. And watch what he does. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you for the power of God in my life. I know that there are many people today that are watching that they could identify with this same power. But Father, there are many that are struggling today. And they're struggling just to hang on. So Father, I pray that you would help them. I pray you would strengthen them. I pray that God, that you would make yourself real to them. God, that they would trust you. I know, Father, with so many things happening in and around our world, we're seeing so many crazy things going on in our world around us. And Father, fear can grip our hearts. And your word says you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. So Father, I speak against fear in the lives of believers today. Help us not to live or walk by fear, but to walk by faith, to trust you, to know that, God, you have got this. You are in control. Father, whatever your people need today, I'm asking that you would meet them at the point of their need. Help them to trust you. Help them to realize who you are in their lives. And Father, I pray for anyone here today in this prayer by saying, Jesus, I thank you that you died on the cross for my sins. I ask you to come into my heart and into my life. I give myself to you today. And I will follow you all the days of my life. I confess you as my Lord and as my Savior. I believe God raised you from the dead. Fill me with the Holy Spirit and help me follow you all the days of my life. Father, I pray for your people. I pray for the people of Chatham, Kent, that God, you would just instill them with faith. And Father, you would make yourself real to them. Thank you for the privilege and the opportunity for us to be able to come into the homes of people week after week after week. Thank you for the ability we have with technology to be able to do what we're doing today. Be with your people. Make yourself real to them. And may the peace of God shine upon their lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm so glad you allowed us the opportunity. If you need prayer, please don't hesitate. Contact us. We'd love to have that opportunity to pray with you. God bless you.